destruction of the first tablets on which the Ten Commandments were written, God invited Moses to return to Mount Sinai to receive replacements. While there, he has conversed with God. His face reflects God's splendor and power, so much so that he wears a veil to avoid overwhelming the Israelites. A reading from the book of Exodus. Moses came down from Mount Sinai. As he came down from the mountain with the two tablets of the covenant in his hand, Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone, because he had been talking with God. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, the skin of his face was shining, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the leaders of the congregation returned to him, and Moses spoke with them. Afterward, all the Israelites came near, and he gave them in commandment all that the Lord had spoken with him on Mount Sinai. When Moses had finished speaking with them, he put a veil over his face. But whenever Moses went in before the Lord, he came out, and when he came out and told the Israelites what he had been commanded, the Israelites would see the face of Moses, that the skin of his face was shining, and Moses would put the veil on his face again until he went in to speak with him. The word of the Lord. Began with prayer and grew into a profound religious experience. Jesus discusses his departure with Moses and Elijah. He is embarking on the path of doing God's will, as Moses the lawgiver and Elijah the prophet had done for him. A reading from the Gospel according to Luke. Now about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter, John, and James, and went up on the mountain to pray. And while he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." Not knowing what he said, while he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone, and they kept silent in those days, told no one any of the things that had been seen. The Gospel of the Lord.
So it happened, Moses was coming down from the mountain of Sinai with the two tablets of treaty in the hand of Moses. And while he descended from the mountain, Moses did not know that he had horns while he spoke with God. Now, the reason they have shining in our NRSV and many, many other Bibles is because the Hebrew word is actually horn. Is not shining. I don't know how they got to shining. But it was translated, it's in the Vulgate, which is the Latin translation of Scripture by Jerome many years ago. And horn is the word that was used. And somehow it's gotten translated into shining, which I suppose is more acceptable. except the common Bible wasn't all that common, because you had to read Latin to be able to read the Bible. And all, the only people that could read Latin back then were priests and scholars. So we call it the Vulgate, or the Common Bible, but that was the translation, and actually that was far more accurate than, at least in some instances, like this one, is horns, like the horn of an ox. Now, if Moses came down the mountain with some kind of radiance, maybe a ghost-like experience, that would be uncomfortable. But I can see the people backing away when Moses comes down with horns. that would create fear in me as well. But it also makes me wonder. I have a question in my mind. How many horns do we see in life? How many people with horns do we see? Our first impression is that, well, they're off base, they're wrong, they're really despicable people, and yet at some point we have a transformation. And suddenly we see, perhaps, that they're not wrong. Maybe it's me that's out of step. There are lots of situations, at least for me, I've experienced many where someone, oh, I have a teacher. Teacher. I had many teachers. I thought I had horns. You know, they didn't understand. They didn't understand me. They didn't believe me when I lied. But are there people in your life, your experience, who had horns at first appearance, and then suddenly you discover that maybe they're of truth and not of life? Well, I can see this dialogue is not going very far. I think about the Refuge Church, Refuge Ministry. I don't know how many of you have been in that ministry. I've been on many lately. And when I make a commitment, I follow through. And so there are things that I've committed to that I really didn't want to do, but I committed to it, so I did it. And there would be like Friendship Feast in Ponca City in Kentucky. There were other kinds of feeding programs and ministries. And it's frankly, it's an inconvenience to go in the evening when I'd rather be home with my wife, my dog, my cat. But I made a commitment. And it's interesting because while I'm there, things begin to happen in me. And by the time I leave, I am really glad I went, because I'm the one who's been blessed. There's a transformation that takes place. The ministries are the same. They haven't changed. And in fact, many times they're exactly the same. That is, we go in, we have prayer, we feed, we clean up. That doesn't change. Many of the people that are there, they don't change. There are those that don't look too good. There are those who don't smell too good. And they're there week after week. They haven't changed. But the transformation, to my knowledge, maybe they have. But the transformation I'm talking about is my transformation. Because I am transformed by our conversation or our experience together. The Refuge, I sat down with, the tendency is to sit down with our own people, to sit down and eat. But I sat down with I don't like this phrase, I sat down with them, with our guest, and had a conversation, another conversation. And it's interesting to learn about their lives, about what brought them here, why they are where they are. I think there's a lot of people that we see with horns former. If you grab hold of one of the horns, one of the four, you were granted a saddle, and so you were protected. So the horns have both good and bad. We tend to look at horns belonging to Satan, and that's bad. But there are many horns. There are horns of oxen, deer, there's many, many kinds, and they're not all bad. But we tend to have that look. But we do the same thing like with the commandments. When we talk about the commandments, we talk about something that's, God demanded the Ten Commandments. You hear preachers that talk about blood and sacrifice, the Ten Commandments. Well, the Ten Commandments, if you remember what I read, was really more of a treaty. It was a peace treaty from God to the people that you will have peace. All you have to do is follow these rules. All you have to do is follow this way, and something good will happen. See, that's the way of a prophet. Prophets are not people who forecast the future. They do not know the future. What they do is they can tell you that if you continue in this way, then this is what's going to happen. If you continue doing these things, it's not going to be good. If you continue doing these things, it's going to be good. So this was a treaty from God that was brought to the people. Then we go to the New Testament, the scripture reading for today, and earlier in chapter 8, Jesus teaches something about revelation. He said in chapter 8, nothing is hidden that will not be disclosed, nor is anything secret that will not become known and come to light. And it appears that on this night was to be a night of light and new knowledge. Jesus predicting his death on this night. And then Peter blurts out, Peter says, Master, it is well that we are here. Let us make three booths, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. And like Peter, we want to hold those mountaintop experiences and not let loose of them. If we could just hold on to them forever, or at least for a little while. Now, I don't know about you, but I live most of my life in the valley. And that's, I'm not talking about depression. I don't mean that. Most of my life is spent in the valley, and I'm very comfortable in the valley. I like the valleys. When Kathy and I travel, we like to go to the mountains. And we go up to the mountains, and I love to look down in the valley. And I love to see those homes, those little houses, little farms. And I like to think of myself driving down and going home. That's a comfortable place to be, a very beautiful setting. But there are times we need to go to the mountain. We need to go to the mountain to experience God in a different way. The mountains were always experiences of places where God made revelations. So here's Peter. He wants to preserve this. I think Luke is attempting to tell us that we cannot stay on the mountain or in the clouds. Ministry is down in the valley. We may need to find a retreat now and then, but ministry is in the trenches. It is with the refugees in the United States, a medical school in Vietnam, a healthcare in Somalia, or food distribution in Africa. And all of these are ministries we are involved with through the Week of Compassion. We do that. So anyway, here we are. A people preparing to leave the valley. interpretation